Green Willow Books, an imprint of HarperCollins Publishers and Harper Audio present No Map, Great Trip, A Young Writer's Road to Page One by Paul Fleischman, read by Andrew Eiden. 1. Voices in the Night. I'm 10 years old and have the glittering good luck to live across the alley from a man who works for a toy company. He needs a boy to pose for a photo in the company's catalog. In exchange, the boy can pick any one item from its pages. Am I interested in being such a boy? Am I ever? The photo shoot takes minutes, but I spend an eternity with the thick catalog. It's like a mile-long candy counter. I dawdle for days, then finally decide on the shortwave radio. In truth, it's a kit, a collection of parts that could conceivably become a shortwave radio. The neighbor brings it over after work, but assembling it is beyond me. If my parents are less than thrilled with inheriting this task, they don't show it. Maybe they're attracted by the challenge. They've recently taught themselves to lay bricks and graft trees. They clear off a table and dig in. They'll need a lot of tools, including a soldering iron and flux to join wire to metal. Fortunately, it's 1962, an era where calling a plumber or electrician is a last resort. My Aunt Dorothy has a drill press, bandsaw, and anvil. Of course my parents own a soldering iron. They spend days decoding the instructions. They wind copper wire around coils, screw part X to Y, then solder CC to DD, a puff of smoke rising from the soldering iron's worksite. At last, the radio is finished. I'm buzzing with high-voltage excitement. It has 5 different bands. For an antenna, my father runs a length of copper wire from the peak of the roof into my bedroom window and affixes it to the back of the set. My mother and 2 sisters gather around. I turn it on. Suddenly, voices that had been whizzing imperceptibly around us are audible. We hear transmissions from a dispatcher to police cars, then offshore fishermen talking to their wives on land. Yeah. Long pause. Pretty good. Longer pause. Maybe Wednesday. For some reason, we can only hear the fishermen's side of the conversation. They don't talk much. We try a different band and are plunged into a strange land of electronic beeps and burbles. We find a station that sounds like a ticking clock. Every 5 minutes it announces the time. Strange. We creep cautiously ahead, hear Morse code, pass through another forest of static, then make out a male voice speaking English. That concludes the news from Radio Havana, Cuba. We've got Cuba. The shortwave really can pick up stations from other countries. Cuba is only 90 miles from the U.S. Can we hear something farther away? We try another band. On the hour, we hear the slow tolling of a bell. Then a female voice announces, "You're listening to the Foreign Service of the BBC." The British Broadcasting Corporation. My parents say that the bell is the famous Big Ben in London. We're hearing England. I'm wowed. My world until now has been Santa Monica, California. School, the beach, Los Angeles beyond. But the shortwave allows spirit travel. Later that night, I'm listening to Australia. Then to a Canadian Broadcasting Corporation announcer who's reading letters sent by listeners to be shared over the air to family living beyond mail delivery in the country's far north. In the morning, I see written down on the legal pad by the radio the frequencies my father frequented after I went to sleep. 10 o'clock, 11450, Radio Berlin International. 1020, 11825, New Zealand. 1045, 15165, The Voice of the Andes, Quito, Ecuador. I put a world map up on my wood-paneled wall and stick flag pins in the capitals of countries I've heard. More important, I get a copy of the World Radio Handbook. This holds something crucial about stations: their addresses. Shortwave listeners send reception reports to stations, giving the date, time, frequency, the program heard, and how strong the signal was. This is useful to stations. In return, they send postcard-sized confirmations to listeners, called QSL cards. Shortwave buffs cherish their collections, especially cards from hard-to-hear stations. I already collect coins and stamps, but QSL cards come with an added lure, getting stuff in the mail. I begin mailing out reception reports. Long weeks pass. Then the first QSL arrives. It's in an envelope that also has a station decal. Cool. More drift in, accompanied by maps, brochures, station schedules, flags. I've barely gotten a letter in my life, but now I'm getting nearly as much mail as my parents. Radio Peking sends me a medallion engraved with the head of China's ruler Mao Zedong. We get Christmas cards that year from radio stations in Indonesia, East Germany, Argentina. On TV, everyone is white and either riding a horse or living happily in the suburbs. There are only three national television networks, all similar. But the shortwave opens windows onto hundreds of different cultures. I listen to programs devoted to Caribbean music, the cricket scene in India, saunas in Finland. I like to stay up late at night and listen to Arabic music, which arrives in waves from the other side of the globe. No such music can be heard on KRLA or the other stations Los Angeles listens to. Shortwave stations broadcast in many languages, but I only speak English. What are you hearing if you don't know the meaning of the words? They're music. French flows like water. Russian sounds like a train wreck of consonants. I often have no idea what language I'm hearing, but keep listening for a while just for the pleasure of the sound. I like Santa Monica. I enjoy school. I'm funny, popular, and the next year will be elected the president of my grammar school. But the shortwave reveals a need for novelty and variety that I didn't know I had. I like leaping over Santa Monica's borders and listening in on life in places I've never seen. In a few years, I'll want to do more than just listen. Most countries have a government-sponsored shortwave station.
The United States' station is called the Voice of America.
I noticed that the news heard there sounds just like the news on AM radio and TV. But Radio Peking calls our armed forces fighting in Vietnam paper tigers and paints us as losing. Until then, I'd only heard positive news about our involvement in Vietnam. This jolts me. The newscasters in Havana praise Cuba's leader, Fidel Castro, who's allied with our enemies, the Russians. I've heard only bad things about both. But the announcers describe advances in agriculture and steeply rising literacy rates. Can this be true? The civil rights movement is in full swing, not only in the U.S., but in South Africa. There, Nelson Mandela has been sentenced to life imprisonment for fighting against segregation. On Radio South Africa, I hear programs describing how happy blacks are with their separate lives. The announcer's voice sounds caring and sincere. I'm older now and suspect he's lying. Kids lie as required, but adults are supposed to keep strictly to the truth. It's disturbing to witness. The red-flagged pins multiply on the world map. We buy a more powerful shortwave with an alluring array of needled dials and tuning knobs. After discovering that stations in Asia come in better in the early morning, I begin tuning in to the Far East before school. At night, I like to sit in the dark and listen through headphones, the lit dials the only light in the room. One night in 1967, I'm combing the bands for new stations when I hear a faint male voice in strongly accented English. The man seems panicked. He describes a military attack, apparently on his station. His voice continually fades out, then returns. Stations usually identify themselves every half hour. The top of the hour arrives, but there's no announcement. I wait 30 more minutes. Still no ID. And then it comes. Radio Biafra, in Africa. The man is broadcasting from the part of Nigeria that's trying to secede, The Biafran War and the starvation that results will cause millions of deaths. The fear in his voice is unmistakable. A universal emotion that makes for instant connection despite the distance and the difference in our circumstances. I have trouble sleeping that night. In the morning, I wonder if the man is still alive. I return to the frequency where I found him, but never hear the station again. The making of writers is mysterious. Much of our schooling takes place out of school, as you'll see in this account of my writerly beginnings. Though you won't find tragedy or trauma here, my path to publication was anything but straight. The pastimes I pursued and the detours I took might look like colossal wastes of time, but consider the shortwave. The exposure to other cultures planted the seeds for the multinational caste and seed folks. Listening to Hindi and Swedish and Swahili showed me the musical side of language, leading to the poetic duets in Joyful Noise and a Newbery Medal. The descriptions of distant places would help launch me on the trip that would be transformed into Whirligig. The realization that history was happening in front of me inspired Dateline Troy and Eyes Wide Open decades later. Most important of all was the long-term effect of hearing Radio Biafra that night. But I'm getting ahead of myself. My charmed childhood had more than just a shortwave. A year or two after it crackled to life, another newcomer joined the family, one who was old, with only one arm, one who gave me brand new eyes. 2. Printer's Devil. My parents drive home one day with the car crammed with cargo of a sort I've never seen. We all help unload. Into the house come wide wooden drawers divided into compartments, a cabinet to hold them, a heavy slab of marble, bags of wooden blocks, boxes filled with bits of lead. Last to emerge is the queen bee of this hive of equipment, a hand printing press. My father, Sid Fleischman, has been a magician, journalist, Hollywood screenwriter, and author of adventures with titles like Murder's No Accident and Danger in Paradise. But the novel he wrote as a lark for my sisters and me has led him into a new realm he's discovered he likes, children's books. His books for young readers are set in the 1800s. Authors need to know their characters' lives in detail, but daily life a century or more in the past was utterly different. How do you find out what people ate for dinner in 1849? Back before the internet, you go to the library. My father checks out histories, diaries, novels. The books are stacked on the piano, then disappear one by one into his study. There, he goes through them looking for the information he needs, copying it into his research notebook. I've looked through it. The price of a bath in San Francisco during the gold rush? An astronomical $10. Dinner in the gold diggings? Bear steak and sow belly and beans. Washed down with coffee, known there as Jamocha. When Praiseworthy, the proper butler in my father's gold rush novel, By the Great Horn Spoon, is challenged by a miner to a fight, he feels honor-bound to confess his advantage. He's read The Gentleman's Book of Boxing.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.